Hi everyone, my name is Ermelin Sebastian-Duggins. I am the Chief Legal Counsel at the St. Kitts Nevis Anguilla National Bank, and I am excited to share with you all that you need to know about obtaining a mortgage, including all the legal and practical implications. Strictly speaking, a mortgage can be defined as a transfer or charge of a legal interest in real property by way of security for the repayment of money. In simple terms, you're using a property that you own or you intend to purchase in order to secure funding from a bank or financial institution. And if you fail to repay that bank, the bank then has the power to sell that property in order to recover whatever monies you owe. The first step in the journey towards obtaining a mortgage is usually finding or locating a property that you're interested in purchasing. And once you've found that property, there are a few things that I would advise that you do before you commit to purchasing that property. The first thing involves the actual physical inspection of the property. Now, buying a property is an investment, and you want to ensure that the property that you're investing in is in good condition. So I would advise that you get an expert or professional to make sure that the structure is sound, including the roof, the walls, etc. Similarly, you also want to do a boundaries check. You want to ensure that there are no boundary disputes with neighboring properties, or that your property is not being encroached upon by any others. Similarly, you want to check access to your property. There are situations where sometimes the access road leading to a property actually runs through someone else's property. And of course, you don't want to buy a property where you would then have to ask permission by someone else just to simply go home. You also want to make sure that no one occupies the property that you were not aware of. So for example, we know of situations where a person squats or occupy a property for a certain period of time, and as a result of that, they can then obtain a right to stay there indefinitely. So of course, you don't want to be that person who invests in a property and you have unwanted occupiers. The second step is to request a copy from the vendor of the title documents to the property. This is what we call commonly your land papers. In St. Kitts and Nevis, persons can hold land either by way of deed, which is what we call unregistered land, or by way of certificate of title, which is what we call registered land. And this is important in order for you to determine initially whether that particular property is held by deed or by title. After you've obtained a copy of the title, you then want to pass this over to an attorney at law, because the next step involves an investigation of title. Now, this is where your attorney goes to the land registry and does a search, and that search should reveal, one, whether the vendor of the property is in fact the legal owner of the property, and two, whether he or she is entitled to sell that property. If it is discovered that the property is held by deed, then the attorney's search can possibly be an extensive one. This is because a deed search requires you to trace ownership of that particular property at least 30 years back in order to find what we call at law good root of title. Now, documents which serve as good root of title are, one, a legal mortgage, two, a conveyance on sale, which is basically a document which passes ownership from one individual to the other, and finally, a deed of assent, which is a document which allows the person legally in charge of a deceased person's estate to pass an asset from the deceased person's estate to the person that is entitled by law to benefit. Once the good root of title is found, the attorney must then review every document in chronological order from the root up to the document which gave the seller ownership. This is to ensure that there are no breaks in the chain of ownership. And this process is extremely critical, particularly in the Caribbean, where we oftentimes take ownership of land very informally. By that, I mean there are situations where a parent may pass and leave children in the home, and those children may believe because they live in the home or because the parent intended to pass the property to them that they automatically have the right to sell the property without taking that legal step. And a search like this would reveal whether or not that particular individual has taken all the steps legally necessary to give them the power to sell the property. Another example of the break in the chain of ownership is where an owner somewhere along the line got a mortgage but did not take that final legal step after repaying the mortgage to have the property reconveyed from the bank back to the owner. Again, unless this final step is taken, that individual does not have that power to sell the property to you, the buyer. If there are no breaks in the chain of ownership, then of course, your attorney will advise you that you're free to go ahead with the purchase. If there are breaks, however, the attorney may advise that this isn't a good purchase, or two, some legal process needs to be undertaken in order to correct the breaks in the chain of ownership. If, on the other hand, the property is held by a certificate of title, the search process is much simpler. In fact, there is no need to trace the history of the transaction, as the register itself is conclusive evidence that the vendor is the valid owner of the property. Even though it's established that the vendor is the valid owner, there are other factors which may prevent him from actually selling the property. One such factor is if there's an encumbrance on the property. An encumbrance is a claim against a property by a third party which prevents the vendor from selling that property. One example of an encumbrance may be a mortgage, which we've discussed earlier. A second example is if a judgment is registered against that property. A judgment is simply an order by the court requiring one party to pay the other party money is owed. Once a judgment is filed and registered, it creates a charge on the property, and that prevents the owner from selling without, of course, satisfying that judgment and having the charge removed. Another example of an encumbrance is what we call lis pendens, or pending action. And this is where some action has been brought against a party in relation to the particular piece of property in question. Once there's a pending action, then the vendor cannot transfer title to anyone else. Interestingly, land and house tax may also be an encumbrance. That is because outstanding land and house tax operates as a first charge against all property. What that means is that the government, through the Inland Revenue Department, has a right to sell your property to recover any outstanding property tax. It also means that if your taxes are not up to date, then the Inland Revenue Department will not sanction any sale. Therefore, it is up to you, the purchaser, to ensure that the vendor provides proof to you that he or she is up to date with the taxes. After all the pre-contract inquiries are completed, one can then enter into a formal contract with the owner, which should outline all the terms and conditions involved with sale of the property. This can either take the form of a purchase and sale agreement or an offer letter which outlines the terms and conditions and which must be signed by you, the purchaser. Now that you've located the property of your dreams and this property checks out, you're going to want to approach your bank or financial institution to discuss funding. Upon approaching your bank, there are some key questions that you want to ask. One, is your bank able to fully fund the purchase of the property? Because of course, banks have different policies as it relates to mortgage loans. Some may require you to come up with a percentage. For example, a bank may say, well, I'll lend you up to 80% and you may have to put 20% in, or I may lend you 95% and you put 5% in. So you want to be clear as to whether or not you have to come up with an input. Secondly, you may want to negotiate your interest rate. So if, for example, the standard rate is 7%, you may want to say, can you do 6%? Can you do 5%? So it's really all about negotiation. Similarly, you may want to negotiate for a longer mortgage period. If it is based on your age, you're entitled to a 20-year mortgage, you may want to push the envelope and perhaps ask the bank to consider 25 years. And of course, the bank will assess your circumstances in order to determine whether or not they will in fact extend it. Another very important area has to do with the expenses associated with mortgages. Believe it or not, there are costs associated. For example, there are closing costs, which you have to pay directly to your loan officer. There are legal fees, which you have to pay to the lawyers for preparing all the security documents, including your mortgage. Additionally, there's VAT to consider, there's stamp duty. So if you're not prepared to pay this money from out of pocket, you want to, of course, ask your lender whether or not these costs can be included in the loan. At this point, your bank is going to ask you to provide it with certain documents that it must consider in determining whether or not you're eligible to obtain a mortgage. One, the bank is going to want to see your purchase and sale agreement just to ensure that the vendor actually intends to sell you the property. Similarly, the bank is also going to require sight of the title document. And of course, they're going to conduct the same search that your attorney would have done just to ensure that the vendor is one, the owner of the property, and two, that the vendor has the power to actually sell the property. Similarly, a valuation of the property is required. And usually you're required to choose a valuator from a list that's normally provided by the bank. Of course, the bank is interested ultimately in your financials. Can you repay this loan? So of course, they're going to require proof that you've been employed for a minimum period of time. Some banks may say 6 months, others may say a year. If you're self-employed, of course, they're going to want to analyze your business accounts. And of course, they're going to want to ensure that you've been running this business again for a minimum period of time. The bank will, of course, analyze your income and your expenses. The question ultimately would be, can this person afford to pay the monthly amount and still live comfortably? Once the bank has examined your documents and done their analysis, the bank will either approve the loan or reject it. Once your loan is approved, however, they will generally provide you with an offer letter, which will outline all the terms and conditions of the loan, including those related to the type of mortgage that is willing to offer you, the insurance that is required, as well as all the fees, including closing costs and legal fees. Now, I know at this stage, persons are often excited and they don't read the terms of the offer. My advice to you is to read the terms. If there are certain terms that you don't understand, please have your loan officer explain. After you sign this offer letter, The matter is usually referred to the bank's attorneys, and they are then instructed to prepare the mortgage documents for you to sign. The type of mortgage that a bank takes will ultimately depend on whether the property is held by certificate of title or by deed. If the property is held by deed, then the option would be an indenture or a deed of mortgage. This is where the borrower actually agrees to convey ownership of the property to the lender on the condition that the lender will return ownership once the loan is repaid in full. If the property is held by a certificate of title, on the other hand, the lender has two options. One, a memorandum of mortgage, which basically allows the borrower to remain the legal owner, but it would offer the bank sufficient rights to sell the property in the event that the borrower does not repay the loan as agreed. The second option is the equitable mortgage, and this is created by the bank simply taking possession or custody of the original certificate of title and having the borrower sign what we call a memorandum of deposit of certificate of title. And this memo of deposit of certificate of title is normally supported by a caveat which would prevent the borrower or the owner of the property from doing any legal transactions with that land. It is often said that bankers love equitable mortgages because if the situation arises where the borrower requires more funding, then they can simply use the equitable mortgage that exists already, as opposed to preparing additional mortgage documents to facilitate further lending. Now, upon getting to your banker's attorney's office, the attorney should present you with your mortgage, and you should have the option to read it and to analyze it and to, of course, ask questions. But there are some key features of the mortgage that ought to be present, which I think is important that you note. One, of course, there'll be a responsibility to pay noted. This would outline, one, the time period that your mortgage should run for. So is it 30 years? Is it 25 years? It should also outline the installments, meaning the monthly amount that you have to pay to the bank. So for example, it may say you have to pay the bank the amount of $3,000 every month and that your date of repayment is the 28th day of each month. This area should also outline your interest rate. But it's important to note whether or not your rate is a fixed rate or a variable rate, which means one, that the bank may have the option in the case of a variable rate to increase your rate of interest or to reduce it. Another important factor in relation to the interest rate is whether you pay this interest rate based on the reducing balance of your loan or whether the interest rate is calculated on the original sum. Note well that usually a penalty for late payment of any installments is normally included. There is also a covenant to repair. And interestingly, this means that you as owner of the property, you have a duty to the bank to ensure that any buildings on the property are kept in good condition and that you would not do anything which would diminish or depreciate the value of the property. The bank usually reserves the right to enter the premises during the daytime to inspect to ensure that you've kept up with your end of this bargain. If you fail to do so, please note that the bank can actually repair the property, but of course, any money that the bank spends will be added onto your loan plus interest. You also covenant with the bank to ensure that your property taxes are up to date. Generally, property owners receive yearly notices from the Inland Revenue Department, which should state the exact amount of taxes owed yearly. And the mortgagee or the bank in this situation may call upon you as the borrower to provide receipts to show that you have in fact made these payments. Again, if you fail to make these payments, the bank can intervene and make your property tax payments, but of course, any amount spent by the bank will be added onto your loan plus interest. You also covenant with the bank to insure any building on the property. Now, this is important because the bank usually requires you to assign the proceeds of the insurance policy to the bank, which means ultimately that in the event there is some damage or some loss as it relates to your property, the insurance company would make that payment directly to the bank as opposed to you, the borrower. This simply leaves the bank with the option of either applying the proceeds of the insurance policy towards repairing your property or, on the other hand, towards paying out whatever monies are owed. This, of course, is a discretion which is left to the bank. In addition to the covenants that you make with the bank also reserves certain rights or remedies as it relates to any breach of these covenants by you. And at this stage, it's usually the bank's attorney's responsibility to outline these remedies to you. Once you're comfortable with the explanation of the bank's attorney, you usually would be required to sign the document in the presence of the attorney, who will witness your signature. At this stage, it is often necessary for you to settle any legal fees or costs associated with preparing the mortgage documents and any other security documents. After fees are paid, and the bank ensures that all insurances are in place, including life insurance, the bank will ultimately prepare for the closing, which means that it will cut a check and make that check payable to the seller or vendor of the property. And at that stage, the bank's attorney will act on your behalf in presenting that check to either the vendor or the vendor's attorney. And the vendor or the vendor's attorney will hand over the original documents to you, as well as any other documents which will help you to register this property in your name. It is also important that you, as the borrower, understands the implications of not repaying your mortgage as agreed. One of the major remedies and most popular remedies is, of course, the power that the bank now has to sell your property in the event of non-payment. Of course, the process of sale will depend again on whether the property is held by deed or by title. Interestingly, if the property is held by deed, the sale process is a much simpler process. At this stage, the bank will simply send you a notice requiring that you repay the money owed, and they will give you a certain period to satisfy this. Sometimes it's 14 days, sometimes it's 28 days. After this is done and there's no favorable response from the borrower, the bank will go ahead and obtain a valuation of the property. And this will be used as guidance as it relates to the price that the bank can accept for the sale of the property. The bank then begins the advertising process, which involves advertising receipt of bids on the particular property. Once the bids are received, the bank will analyze the bid, and usually they'll accept the bid that's in keeping with the amount given by the valuator. Once a bid is accepted, the bank then has the right to transfer the property from the bank in its capacity as mortgagee to the new owner. On the other hand, if the property is held by a certificate of title, then the process is managed entirely by the court. This usually begins with a demand letter being issued to you, the borrower, giving you a certain period of time, usually 14 days, to repay whatever is owed. After that period has expired and the bank doesn't receive any favorable response from you, the bank will then enter into a more formal notice process called a notice to pay off. This notice to pay off gives you a 60-day period to settle the debt. After 60 days, The next step would be serving you with what we call a seizure, which is normally served by the court's bailiff. If after 30 days have passed from the date of serving you with this seizure and no effort to settle the debt or no arrangement to repay has been entered, the next step is normally for the bank to obtain a valuation of your property and to take the sum derived from this valuation and make an application to the court to settle the articles of sale. At this point, the court will normally determine whether or not it accepts the valuer's idea of what the property is worth, and it will set the sale price accordingly. In addition to that, it would prescribe to the bank exactly how it ought to advertise the sale of the property. So, for example, it may say, advertise the sale of the property via newspaper in 3 successive issues of a local paper, or it may require you to use social media. If it's a high-stakes property, it may prescribe that international advertisement is necessary, and that would require the bank to perhaps bring on board a real estate agent that has a far reach in order to attract international bidders. Finally, once the date of auction arrives, persons will enter the courthouse and the sale itself is conducted by the registrar. Persons will bid on the property and the successful bidder would of course be required to make a deposit towards payment and eventually pay the full amount. Once this is completed, the registrar then signs off on the transfer document and this will then transfer the property from the owner to the new purchaser. In sum, my advice to anyone who has entered a mortgage relationship with a bank or financial institution is communication is always key. If ever there is an issue with repayment, communicate with your loan officer as soon as possible in order to avoid it getting to the point of the bank having to exercise this power of sale. At this time, I want to thank the St. Kitts Nevis Bar Association for including this outlet for information as part of its 2021 Law Week of activities. It is my hope that this information is useful and it will be of some help to persons interested in obtaining a mortgage. Once again, thank you for your attention, and if there are any questions, please feel free to contact me.